Feminist Classes in Memory of Jared Olchen. And today we're going to learn about Miriam, the prophetess, Miriam Hanevi'ah. We will start on page 261. Just to know, the name Miriam has two meanings. Miriam means bitter, mar. And if you take out the resh, Miriam is mine. Mem, yud, mem. Take out the resh, it's mine. Water. Mm-hmm. Miriam is connected to water from the beginning to the end. It's all about water. The first time we learn about Miriam, we don't have her name. No name. Nameless person. The whole story is nameless. Right? It starts on page 261. Number one, chapter two, number one. Go ahead.
A man of the house of Levi went and married Levi's daughter.
A man of the house of Levi, no names. Mm-hmm. A man of the house of Levi went and married the daughter of Levi, of a Levi. Fine. Okay.
The woman became pregnant and had a son. She realized how extraordinary the child was, and she kept him hidden for 3 months.
Okay, the Talmud comes here and tells to this man marrying a woman is unusual. Why? Because she was 3 months old. Okay, continue.
When she could no longer hide him, she took a papyrus box, coating it with asphalt and pitch, and she placed the child in it. She placed it in the rushes near the bank of the Nile. Mm-hmm. The child's sister stood herself at a distance.
Let's stop right here. If there is a child's sister, obviously the couple was married before, right? He says a man married a woman and they had a baby. Where is a sister coming from? Obviously it was a sister before. Comes the Talmud and tells us who are the men and who are the women and who are the sister. The Talmud doesn't make this up because, as some will know, that's Moses. Later it's written that Moses, the name of Moses' father and Moses' mother and Moses' sister. That if we know the names of all these three, then we know that who they were. It was Amram was Moses' father. And his mother was named?
Yochevet.
And they had a daughter and a son. Because it's written in the Torah later. Miriam was the daughter. She was the oldest one. Then they had a son with the name Aaron. It was a very nice American Jewish family. With a boy and a girl. And they were about, and then came out this crazy decree from this evil king, his name is Pharaoh, and he ordered to throw every Jewish baby male to the river, to the Nile River. Amram, who was the leader of the Jewish people, said, I cannot take responsibility for such things. Better not to have children. And as he leads by example, he divorced his wife. That's a normal thing to do. That's what, in his way, it was also almost like a demonstration against God. Oh God, how can you allow such a thing? We will never have children. Amram did it. The rest of the Jewish men followed suit. They got divorced. What's the point to have children? For what? Medrash says, the sister, Miriam, the little girl, Miriam was 5 years old, 6 years old, something like this. For sure, not a young girl. She got up and she told her father, you are worse than Pharaoh. What do you mean you are worse than Pharaoh? She told him, Pharaoh only made a decree to kill the boys. By not having children, will be no boys and no girls. Then what? Pharaoh is an evil man. Today is alive. Tomorrow he can die. Right? Then the decree will stop. But if Jewish families are divorced, then will be nothing. We will have not boys and not girls. That was, so far was the lecture that she gave him. It's called a Musa speech. She gave him like a, oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
So question, why is it then hidden in the text? I mean, the Torah is very rich in some ways and poor in others. Why would Hashem hide it at this, mask it at this point, and then provide details later.
Why the name is covered up?
Yeah, why is it covered up?
Because we want to point to bring out Moses. Because it's all about to bring the most important part of the story, that Moses was born. Mm-hmm. The first person gets a name in this little story is Moses. Okay. Then everybody else. Later we go and say, you know who Moses is? He has a father and he has a mother. He's not somebody we picked him up in the river. He's a person who is coming from a very distinguished family. But at that point, when he was found by the river, Pharaoh's daughter didn't know who he is. He was a nobody, from your point of view. But then she told your father something very interesting. After she gave him the speech, and she told them that it's not right to do such things, she told them, I prophesy that my mother will give birth to the Redeemer of the Jewish people. That's what she told them. Aha, now you're talking.
At the young age, she told them?
At 5 or 6 years old. Interesting enough, you almost don't have stories of biblical people of when they're children. Well, you know a story about a child of doing things. I mean, Moses is born. Yeah. Abraham, the first story. How old is Abraham and God when the Torah tells about him in the first story?
48.
When the Torah said, the Torah reads...
Oh, 75.
75. Isaac, not as a child. Yeah, he gave him a breeze. That's it. He didn't do anything. Jacob and Esau, the children grow up to be, and one was this and one was this. There is no stories of children. I cannot even recall. Can anybody recall
Joseph,
any story?
17.
Again, not 5, not 7, not 9.
Ishmael at 13.
Also, what his father asked him if he wants to be circumcised. He said yes.
Yeah. Only Rebecca at the well.
Rebecca at the well. Yeah, that's true. She was young. Also, not so clear in the Bible how young she was. Some opinions say 3. Some people say 12 or 13. Then... But you're right, Rebecca, another example. You see, if there is any stories, it's about women, not about men. I'm serious. Here she comes and she gives a prophecy. And the interesting part is, her father is listening to her. And he remarries his wife. And who would then stand the wedding? Aaron and Miriam. Obviously, didn't bring 500 guests to the wedding. It was Aaron and Miriam. She remarried, and you know what? A child was born, and the child that was born, as the Talmud says, the whole house became illuminated and the baby was born. What does this mean? Hello. The whole house became illuminated. It means to say, anybody who looked on the baby saw this is a special child. That's not a normal child. And your father told her, oh, Miriam, you know what you're talking about. That she became a prophetess by the age of 5 or 6. Very young. That's no question at all about. 3 months passed. The baby is he cannot hide them anymore. You have to do with them something. The father said to her, Amram tells Miriam, no, Miriam, no. What's it, your prophecy? You're a chacham to tell me to have a child? Now what? You said he's going to be the Redeemer. Exactly what's going to be with him? Then they put him into the they decided to put him in the river. What was the logic behind putting him in the river?
A couple of things. One, there's prophecy because that he should be protected by the water, that they can't see him through it, that it...
You're going far. What's on a regular? You're the mother. The Egyptian police, KGB, is looking for him, for a baby, every Jewish baby boy. You want to hide them. So I cannot hide them anymore. You know what? I'll put them in the river.
Babies are being drowned in the river, so any cries are going to be masked by, or they're not going to be suspicious because, you know, baby in the river, of course, there are babies being thrown in the river.
No, that they wanted to throw him in the river and light him?
What was the logic? If he cries.
He's turning it over to Hashem. It's in Hashem's hands.
Yeah, and why? You wouldn't hear it.
The mother wouldn't hear it. Then why in the river? I would put him in the mall. Crazy. I mean, what's the logic behind it? Why in the river? What was the like? Put him, give him up for adoption. He wants to die. Give him over to the police. Let them do. I mean, wait for the police to come and whatever will be. You are going and you're killing him yourself. I mean, what?
Did they know that that's where the Pharaoh's daughter was always was?
They had no clue that Pharaoh's daughter is going to come and find her.
They didn't technically put him in the river. They put him on the bank and allowed.
Then will be what will be them? Yeah, what do you think? What do you think will be them? How long can a baby be in a box on the river?
No, I understand. It's because it's up to Hashem.
The logic is that every Jewish baby, the destiny of every Jewish baby boy was to make it to the river. That Yocheved saw it, my son is not going to escape the destiny of the Jewish people. If that's what God wants every baby to go, I better put it myself down and then leave it up to God. Will we see the same logic in the story of Esther? Esther was by the king, and Mordechai tells her, go beg the king to change the decree of Haman, right? The story of Purim. And Esther says, he didn't call me for 30 days, the king, and if you come to the king without being summoned, you've been killed. That the first line that Mordechai told her is, don't think that you will escape the destiny of the Jewish people from all the Jews because of being by the king. That means to say, if God decided that all the Jews should die, God forbid, don't think you're going to escape the destiny. That's what Yocheved knew too. Yocheved said, I'll put him in the river. Every Jewish boy has to make it to the river, I'll put him in the river. And now we'll leave it up to God. If that's the direction, I'll go there too.
Her way of saying it wasn't Pharaoh's decree, it was really God's decree.
If everybody, nobody can escape it, then this is it. That's what, yeah, absolutely. That's meant to be. I'll put him there, and now I'll leave it up to God. Who is going after the baby to see what will happen? The normal reaction would be
the mother.
The father. The mother. That would be the normal thing. She cannot leave your child. It's a mother. The father, the brother was younger. I mean, an aunt, who knows? A young girl, she went there. Why she went there? Because she gave the prophecy. She felt responsible for it. That even she was very young, and even in the movie, it's very hard to hide there in the by the river. She stood there to see what will happen to him. What would happen to him, right? That was the language. Now we'll go to page 263 in the top of the page.
Pharaoh's daughter went to bathe in the Nile while her maids walked along the Nile's edge. She saw the box in the rushes and sent her slave girl to fetch it. Opening the box, she saw the boy. The infant began to cry, and she had pity on it. It is one of the Hebrew boys, she said.
Okay, Pharaoh's daughter found him. That was, I mean, talking about miracles, that's the chief, the top miracle, that she came and she saw him. She opened the box. How she know he was Jewish?
Crying.
First of all, it was, which baby is by the river by itself? It would be a Jewish baby. Number two, according to the matter, she was circumcised. That she know, at that time, it wasn't the common thing to circumcise. It was a very normal thing. It was only a Jewish people did it. It obviously was Jewish. That she, not like in the movie, he didn't have a talus or anything like this. I'm sorry. It was before the days of talusim. She saw it's a Jewish baby. Now she sees a baby who is crying. Right? The text said it. She was crying. She said, it's a Jewish baby. For sure the baby is crying. He's hungry. He's 3 months old. Now the sister stands there. Miriam. What should Miriam do? Should she come over to him? To tell her he's a Jewish baby? Is it good? Is it bad? This moment of decision, what Miriam should do, that takes a prophet. To come over, to make this one moment decision, to come over and to say, let's read what happened. Number 7. Mark.
The infant's sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call a Hebrew woman to nurse the child for you?
that takes a lot of chutzpah to say such a thing. She comes to Pharaoh's daughter is the daughter of Hitler who comes down and she finds a baby. The natural thing you would think, she would take the baby, At worst, throw him straight in the river. At the best, give him over to the authorities and let the authorities do with him the right thing. Now she comes over to Miriam. She can the normal, even more. She could say, maybe we'll give it up back to the Jewish people. Here, Miriam comes to her and says, "You're looking to a way to." She probably tried to nurse her. If she's telling her, you're looking for a nurse. Obviously, Pharaoh's daughter was looking for a nurse. She says, "I'll bring you a Jewish nurse." She says, "Yeah, go."
The prophecy that Miriam has is different than the prophecy of the prophets, because it has to be more direct. She's not getting this in a dream or anything like
it's
that.
It's not even in the Torah text.
It's not, prophecy, it's to do the right thing at the right moment and to get up and to do it. And it works. You know, it's Paul's prophecy. It came from God. To get up and to go to this woman and to tell her, to the daughter of Pharaoh, the daughter of the king, the most powerful king in the world, a Jewish girl gets up and says she's on the slave, she's on the minority, is persecuted and tortured and killed, and to go to Pharaoh's daughter and tell her, "You want, I should call her Jewish?" And she says, "Go." That was an unbelievable miracle right there. And that's Pharaoh's, that's Miriam did it.
So did Miriam get the prophecy that Moses was going to be saved by Pharaoh's daughter?
No. Miriam had a prophecy that he's going to be the redeemer of the Jewish people. That whatever will be, this guy will be saved. That if now we have to go and to tell her, "I'll bring you a Jewish nurse," then that's what will work. This intuition, this moment of making the decision and going over and saying the right word and it should work, that's God's walking through people. Then the prophecy was in the beginning. She told her father that a Jewish baby, my mother is going to give birth to the Jewish Redeemer. But now to take care of the Redeemer. Think about it. First of all, two things here. Number one, who saved Pharaoh? Who saved Moses? I'm sorry.
Pharaoh's daughter.
Three women. Pharaoh's daughter, Miriam, and you have it. Three women saved the Redeemer of the Jewish people. Not only this, the first story with Miriam is mine, connected to water. It was right by the water. She was there standing by the water. Moses was redeemed, was saved because of from the water. Right? She told her, "Go." Let's finish the story. Go replied.
"Go," replied Pharaoh's daughter. The young girl went and got the child's own mother. "Take this child and nurse it," said the Pharaoh's daughter to the mother, "and I will pay you a fee." The woman took the child and nursed it. When the child matured, his mother brought him to Pharaoh's daughter. She adopted him as her own son and named him Moses, Moshe. Mm-hmm. I bore him from the river, she said.
Then it's unbelievable. First of all, the story cannot get any better. You cannot even make up such a story. Not only they pay the mother to nurse the baby.
The real mother.
Then the real mother. And then when the child grows up, but she has to give him up. She has to give him up. The separation, the pain, the... It's even worse after you nurse the child for 2 years, whatever it was the time. But what Pharaoh's daughter called him, Moshe, the name made a statement. I draw him out of the water. My father draws all the babies to the water. I'm taking him out from the water. That Pharaoh's daughter was the opposite of Pharaoh. And in Pharaoh's house, she was raised a Jewish boy. Everybody knew it's a Jewish boy. There was no mistakes there. And Pharaoh's daughter decided that that's her baby and finished. And even the big Pharaoh who controls the whole world didn't have strength over his daughter. She was going to start up with her. She'll start to cry and yell. She'll make her turn over the whole house. Okay, you want this. As long as you find peace in the house, right? Anything. That's the first story with Miriam. But Miriam's name is not named. It's not mentioned. Pharaoh, it's Moses' sister. Here she is, Moses' sister. The second story of Miriam is in this week's parsha.
Before we get there,
yes,
Pharaoh's daughter, this is really the first example, maybe the second, of civil disobedience. I mean, you've got the two midwives who refuse to do what Pharaoh says. Mm-hmm. You've got Pharaoh's daughter.
According to the Midrash, the two midwives were Yocheved and Miriam. Mm-hmm. Shifra and Pua. Mm-hmm. That was Yocheved and Miriam. Yes. It's not only civil. That's the first example of something much more than that. Pharaoh's daughter is the first righteous Gentile. Mm-hmm. Pharaoh's daughter is a statement that we should not lose hope in people. When you walk, you are in the middle of the Holocaust, you look around, millions are killing, and the whole world says nothing. Did you say to yourself, you know what? It's not worth it to be alive in such a world. There is no good, nothing good here. And then you see this little thing of good people who are risking their life to save lives. And don't have an obligation. Pharaoh's daughter was the first example in this old horrible story of the suffering of Jews in Egypt. Pharaoh's daughter was the light. There, even in Pharaoh's house, can something good come out? Don't give up. It's not the end of the world. Many people after the Holocaust were very disillusioned. They didn't want to do anything. They didn't want to have children. They didn't want to deal with life. It's a bad world. Look what's going on. He said, there is good people in everything, in everywhere. Don't give up. The 25,000 people who are mentioned, who are engraved in the Yad Vashem as the people who risked their life to save Jews, that's the hope of humanity. To say that everybody is bad is easy, but it's very hard, because if everybody is bad, we are bankrupt. That's over. We just the opposite. The Torah teaches us, look, Pharaoh's daughter. In Pharaoh's house, the worst place, the best thing happened. Now we'll go to page 3. This week's parsha, page 331. This week's parsha, Beshalach, is about the splitting of the sea. The Jewish people are going out from Egypt. They're coming to the sea, the Egyptians running behind them. The Jews get all frustrated. They start to pray to God and complain to Moses. That's a normal reaction. That's the way it goes. You pray to God and you complain to Moses. How do you take us out of Egypt? God makes an unbelievable miracle. The splitting of the sea, the whole nation is going through. And then the Egyptians are running after them, are running straight into the water and being swallowed up. The Jewish people, Moses taught the famous Song of the Sea. Or Az Yashir Moshe. It's so powerful and so important in Jewish tradition that we say it every day in the prayers. Every morning we say Az Yashir Moshe, the prayer from this parsha. And in some synagogue, it's even written in the Torah, if you look on the page before, on page 329, it's written like poetry. That's the way it's written in the Torah itself. It's not written with regular lines. A beautiful Moses is leading the whole Jewish nation. If you look at the beginning on page 327, it's written, Moses and the Israelites then sang this song to God. Right? The whole nation was singing.
Is this the only song, the only time that it...
There is one more time. Yeah, in the end of the Torah, by Azinu. Two songs like this. Then, that's everybody singing. Looks like everything was good, right? Everybody was singing and praising God. Beautiful. Look to page 331. Miriam's song. Who's supposed to read? Mrs. Cousin, go ahead.
19?
Yeah, 20.
Miriam, the prophetess, Aaron's sister, took the drum in her hand, and all the women followed her with drums and dancing. Miriam led them in the response, sing to God for his great victory, horse and riders, he cast in the sea.
Okay, first of all, what happened there? This story is also with water, right? Mm-hmm. Miriam, with water, has to do with the water. Miriam the prophetess, she's named Miriam the prophetess. First of all, we know her name, Miriam. Not only Miriam, the prophetess. Very few people get in the Bible, not even about Moses. It's not written Moses the prophet. It's written that Moses was a prophet. Don't get me wrong. But the title Moses the prophetess is not there. Miriam the prophetess is the only prophet in the Bible that's named Miriam the prophetess is Miriam. Not Aaron the prophet, not Moses the prophet, not Jacob the prophet, nobody. Miriam the prophetess. Then we give her a name, we say, you know who Miriam is? Aaron's sister. Why not Moses' sister? Moses is the claim to fame. Didn't she save Moses, right? Why Aaron's sister? And then what they did, they took the tambourines, right? They took, she took all the women with the drums. And the tambourine says, where are their drums from? the Jewish women had such faith in God that they had drums with them. They said, we're going to have such miracles, it's going to be unbelievable. We're going to sing and dance, and it's going to be... They had so much faith that they prepared the drums to sing with, to dance with. There is a story about two women came to a Hasidic Rebbe in Poland to ask for a blessing for children. He gave them both a blessing. And then a year later, one of them had a baby, the other one didn't. And the one who didn't have the baby came to this Rebbe. She told him, Rebbe, well, I'm not good enough. Why? Here yes and me not. He says, I don't know. I gave both of you the same blessing. Go ask her what she did after the blessing. He says, I went to ask her to say, what you did after? He said, after the blessing, I went to the store and I bought a bassinet and I bought a carriage and I bought diapers and bottles and everything. She comes back to the Rebbe. She says, that's what she did. He says, your faith in the blessing made the blessing become a reality. The Jewish women were so sure that it's good. When you are ready to prepare tambourines to go to celebrate, you have faith that it's going to work out. It's the Jewish women who had children in Egypt. The men did not want to have children. The Jewish women seduced the men to have children because they believe that it's going to be good. Don't worry about it. Just let's have the children. It's going to work out. Then that's their tambourines. And not only they were singing, they were dancing too. Then can religious women can sing in front of men? What's going on here? Right? You're not allowed to. What?
If they're seducing the men, they can.
And not in their own men, but they cannot seduce their other men. It doesn't work like this.
Let's try.
They can dance and sing in the bedroom. They can dance the night away. No problem. The answer is that it was such a revelation of godliness there. There was no evil. Why we are afraid? We're afraid of seduction. We're afraid of the evil inclination that will take the wrong turn. At the splitting of the sea, it's written that was the revelation of God. Every maidservant at the sea saw God on a higher level that Ezekiel saw, that Isaiah saw. The Talmud says, a maidservant by the sea saw a greater revelation than the greatest prophets later saw. They saw only on a lower level. There it was such a big miracle, it was like God came full force. When God is there, nobody has any thoughts of other things. It was such a strong revelation of God that now was nothing to be afraid. But that's all the side story. The real question here is, Miriam is running her own show. What's going on here? Isn't Moses the leader? What is this for a business? Finally, Moses became the leader. It wasn't so simple. I'll show you two pages before that how Moses just now really got his authority. On page 327, right before the song, the number 31 before the song. You want to read, Howard?
Uh-huh.
31. The middle of the line. The Israelites saw.
The Israelites saw the great power that God had unleashed against Egypt. And the people were in awe of God. They believed in God and in his servant Moses.
They finally believed in God and Moses' his servant. Finally, Moses gets his authority, comes his sister, and is doing whatever she wants. What a chutzpah. And the Jewish people already was, it's not written anywhere that she asked Moshe, Moses, I want to take a girl to dance with a woman. Would you mind? Nothing. And it's written, according to Rashi, that she was singing as long as a song, as Moses was singing. It's written only one line, but she basically repeated the same song or something like this. Why she did it? The answer is Miriam the prophetess. She's a prophetess, and she has enough authority to go and do. And if she's doing something, it's a prophecy. She had a prophecy, so to speak, to go and dance with the women. She didn't need Moses' permission. She needs Moses' permission. She, because of fear, there is Moses. She gave the prophecy that Moses will be born. Then the Torah answers the question by giving her the title, Miriam the prophetess. If she's the prophet, no questions are asked. She can get up and run on Iran. Iran show after Moses finished his show because she was a prophet. And that's alone, that she doesn't have to ask Moses permission, shows that to a point she's greater than Moses. Just like Sarah was greater than Abraham. In a certain level of prophecy. Obviously, Moses was the ultimate prophet, but that was Mount Sinai. But could be until Mount Sinai, Miriam was greater than him. It's written about Sarah. When Sarah told Abraham to send away Ishmael, Abraham didn't want to. That God told Abraham, listen to what Sarah says. Why? Because she's greater than you. And prophet Rashi says, from here we learn that Abraham was on a lower level of prophecy than Sarah. The same thing happened here. That Miriam, the prophetess, she got up and she led the all women with her own dance. And she had the authority. There is only one question left in this line. Why she is named the sister of Aaron and not the sister of Moses? Didn't she save Moses? If anything, she should be named after Moses, not the sister of Aaron. Then there is, Rashi says, because then one of the explanations that she later, there is a whole story we're going to learn later, that Aaron prayed for her. Aaron stood up for her, so to speak. Therefore, she's named after Aaron. So to speak, Aaron saved their life. But the Rebbe says there's something very interesting. The Rebbe says there is Moses and Aaron at two ways how they led the Jewish people. Moses was more tough love, it's called in America. He was the leader. He couldn't be nice to everybody, smiling. Yeah, do whatever you want. It's okay. It doesn't work like this. He's a leader. He was emet. Emet means the truth. He has to do what needs to be done. He was din. Din means judgment. Aaron was chesed. He was kindness. Aaron was loved peace and pursued peace. Aaron was a guy that everybody loved him. And that's why when Aaron died, actually, the whole nation of Israel mourned him. It's written in the Bible, I'll not make you turn pages too much, but it's written in the Bible when Aaron died, called Beit Israel, the whole house of Israel mourned him. It's not written by Moses, this language. It's written they mourned. Israel mourned, not the whole nation, the whole house of Israel. Because Aaron was more, he used to make peace between husband and wife, between friends, he used to make. It's written in the Medrash, when Aaron died, there were 80,000 kids or 60,000 people were named already Aaron. Because every time when a couple wanted to get divorced and then Aaron made peace, they got together, they had a child, they named them what? Aaron. Then everybody was Aaron in the camp. That's how much he was loved. Moses was Dean. He was the authority. Will we see that it went the wrong way? Then when Moses... When having Aaron alone is not good enough, what do you think?
Oh, the golden calf.
The golden calf, right? Aaron, Moses was at Mount Sinai. Aaron was downstairs. Aaron tried to work it out. It didn't work out. Moses showed up. In a second, was no golden calf, was no nothing. Why? Because Moses was the authority. Aaron was a nice guy. He couldn't do it. The Torah writes here, Miriam was Aaron's sister. The Torah wants to say, what type of leadership was Miriam? Then the Torah says she was like Aaron. You know, not every, usually women when they are leaders, they are tougher than the men. Like Margaret Thatcher was called the Iron Lady. Golda Meir used to be called the only man in the Knesset. She was, the question is, what type of leader was Miriam? The Talmud says, that the Torah says she was Aaron's sister. Aaron's sister means she was nice, she was kind, she was loving, she was in a loving way the leader of the Jewish people. Now, will we see that Moses, Aaron, and Miriam were the three leaders of the Jewish people?
And the clouds of glory and the water. And...
That we know from the Medrash. Will we see in a text that they're all like lined up as one?
Well, they have, right before the whole story of Lashon Hara, they're sitting at the table, basically at a banquet.
It's not written in the text. There was a prophet with the name Micha. Micah?
Yeah,
Micah. Reb Micah told us the story. And chapter is it? Let's see. Yeah, on page 1209. Number 4. Who wants to read?
For I brought you out of the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of bondage. I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam.
Simple as that. I sent before you three leaders, Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, in one line. As we know from the prophet Micah, that it was Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, three leaders. From this comes the cloud of glory and all of this. And right then, we know that Moses, Aaron, and Miriam are three leaders, and this is the second story. It is where it's written clearly that she was a prophet. Right after this story is a story with water, the bitter water. We go to back to page 331, right? There is a complaint that the Jews don't have the water. A minute later, it means again, you see how she connected to water? Right there.
Bitter and water.
Bitter water. The third story of Miriam is, like you said, where is the next story about Miriam? Who knows?
Oh, you're talking about
New Scholars. Mark
saying Lashon Hara.
Where is it?
Over page 721?
No. yeah, actually, yes. I think, what's wrong here? Yeah, 721, yes.
No, it's what you said.
721. It's in the book of Numbers, in Parshat Be'alotcha, 721. That's the third story about Miriam. That's already a while later. Miriam here, here is a story, a very interesting story. Not such a we'll see soon what is happening here. Okay, let's start to read a little bit, then we'll be able to understand what happened. Miriam and Aaron complain. That's not nice, doesn't Aaron, sound good.
And Aaron began speaking against Moses because of the dark-skinned woman he had married. The woman that Moses had married was indeed dark-skinned.
Okay.
They then went on to say, is it to Moses exclusively that God speaks? Doesn't he also speak to us?
Okay, what's going on here? It was a time that Moses appointed new leaders, new prophets. Moses complained to God and he says, God, I cannot handle the Jewish people by myself. God told him, okay, appoint 70 leaders. 70 leaders, basically it's a whole story. Two people prophesized, according to one opinion. All the 70 prophesied. It was a big event. Everybody was sitting down. And Miriam said, how lucky these people, the women of this man, that their husband became prophets, became leaders. They have the spirit of God on them. Zipporah was sitting next to her, and she says, lucky. That's it. She said, what's wrong? That she told her that since Mount Sinai, Moses doesn't know her anymore. I mean, he comes home, says hello and goodbye, but that's about it. That Miriam was upset. She turned to Aaron and she told them, is Moses the only lead, the only one that God speaks to him? We also speak to God, and we still live a normal family life. Moses, basically, when he came down from Mount Sinai, he felt that he has to be ready for God at every minute, that he cannot engage in marital relations. Then he wanted to be all for God. But nobody ever heard about it. No, it was a personal thing. Suddenly, it like came out like in a second. Where Moses got the idea that he has to be with God and he cannot go back to the people. It's written on page 899. I'm sorry for confusing you a little bit, but it's good. 899, the Torah describes the second the story of Mount Sinai. In Deuteronomy, the Torah repeats the whole story again. That in 899, Hashem tells the Jewish people, after Mount Sinai experience, he tells them on number 27, God tells Moses, go ahead.
Go tell them to return mm-hmm. to their tents.
Go tell the Jewish people, return to your tents. You need to understand, before Mount Sinai, 3 days before, the Jewish people were not allowed to be engaged in marital relations. Now Mount Sinai is over. He tells Moses, go tell them they can go back home. But you, continue, you however.
I will declare, you however must remain here with me.
You, however, must remain with me. That Moses understood from this that he has to remain with him for good. According to the Talmud, it was Moses' decision and God agreed. Moses felt it. It wasn't that God initiated it. Moses felt that this is the right thing, and God said, God agreed with Moses' opinion. Now, then that's where it's coming. Now we'll go back to our story. That Miriam speaks to Aaron about Moses. She's the older sister, right? She has the right. Why she was so concerned with Moses? Why she cared? You know why she cared? Miriam was always cared for having babies, right? Didn't Miriam convince her father to remarry her mother? Now she wants to do the same thing. She wants to convince Moses to go back to his wife. She's continuing to do what she did before, but she knows the best. She cares. She says, if Moses will give birth to another Moses, can you imagine? The Jewish people miss out? Because as we all know, the two children of Moses, you even know what their names are.
Gershom or something.
Gershom.
That's one, and the second one?
Eliezer.
Gershom Eliezer. They known in the Jewish people, nothing. We don't know anything about them. She thought maybe be a third child, maybe this will be the Moses. That she wanted, she had good intention. But God didn't like it at all that she's giving Moses a pin. She's talking to Aaron about Moses. First of all, if you have something to say, go to Moses and tell him. Don't tell Aaron about Moses. But more than that, it was a little more than that. She had good intention. She wanted Moses to be married. She did it once. She was successful. If not for real bravery, Moses wouldn't be around, right? She says, maybe I will give birth to him. I'll make sure that there is another Moses. Let's read in page 721, number 4. even before God heard it. Moses, however, you see
God
this?
God heard it. Moses, however, was very humble, more so than any man on the face of the earth.
Wow. The Torah says it. The Torah testified that Moses was more humble than any man on the face of the earth. It means to say that how could you be so humble? What means to be humble? Just for a little moment. What means to be humble? To say I'm a nothing? If somebody asked you, asked Mark, are you a doctor? He says, no, I'm not. Is he humble or is he a liar? You're a lawyer? No, I'm not. You're lying. Being humble doesn't mean not to know your capabilities. You're thinking that you're a shmata is not humbleness. It's being a shmata. That has a different name for it. Humbleness means to know what you are, to know your capabilities, but to understand that this is because God gave it to me. And if somebody else would have this opportunity, he would do a better job. That Moses looked at every Jew in the Jewish people, says, Moses knew that he's the leader, but he says, if Josh Moore would be the leader, they would do a better job. Shame on me. They would all do, if they would have my opportunities, my capabilities, my talents, my parents, my power, what God gives me, they would do a much better job. That's why Moses was the most humble man, because he was thinking to himself always, anybody else would do a better job than me, if they would have my chances. Okay,
God suddenly said to Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, all three of you go out to the communion tent.
That was the place that God spoke to them. Mm-hmm. Okay.
When the three of them went out, God descended in a pillar of cloud and stood at the tent's entrance. He summoned Aaron and Miriam, and both of them went forth.
For a private conversation, not in front of Moses. Because God couldn't, God said, God didn't want to praise Moses in front of him. And he wanted to tell Miriam and Aaron who Moses is. What is he telling them?
God said, listen carefully to my words. If someone among you experiences divine prophecy, then I will make myself known to him in a vision. I will speak to him in a dream. This is not true of my servant Moses, who is like a trusted servant throughout my house. With him I speak face to face in a vision not containing allegory, so that he sees a true picture of God. How can you not be afraid to speak against my servant Moses?
Okay, there is a lot to be said in these few lines. But let's take it little by little. He says, what Miriam said to Aaron, isn't God speaking to us too? He says, don't compare yourself to Moses. I speak to you, and I speak to you, and I speak to you. But Moses is a whole different level. To all other prophets, God speaks by vision, by dream, by pictures. For example, you see the prophet says, I saw a menorah. I saw, Joseph saw stars, or he saw the sheaves, right? Pharaoh saw cows, by different pictures. Face to face, mouth to mouth. It's not face to face. Pale, pale, double boy means face to face. A mouth to mouth. God speaks to a mouth to mouth. Means the clear vision that nobody has.
Why do all the translations say face to face? Because that's really problematic. And like the prior reference saying nobody can see God face to face.
Pale, pale means mouth to mouth.
But the English translations just really.
I really don't know why they use it face to face, Taki. I don't.
Yeah, mouth to mouth. You can't see my face and live.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Mouth to mouth means almost like a kiss of lovers. The idea is that I have an intimate relationship with them. That's what it means.
Rabbi, why did Miriam get punished but Aaron did not?
Slowly, slowly. I'll get them. Oh, maybe, sorry. Maybe. Then he says, how dear you spoke about my servant Moses. You know what God told them? First of all, God says he's my trusted servant. You know what means my trusted servant? A tzaddik, a real tzaddik, a big prophet, knows things about people, but he's not allowed to tell them. He sees a person, and he knows what's going to happen to him in a half hour, and he wants to tell him, don't go there, don't go! They cannot tell him. He's trusted. A trusted servant means you can trust them that he will not give out the secret. He's trusted in my house means God says all the keys are open for him. I trust them everywhere. A trusted prophet, trusted servant. Somebody gives that secret. There is a story about a Hasidic Rebbe. I think it was the Maggid of Mezrich, that once his disciple came to him and told him, Rebbe, I'm leaving. Goodbye. I want to say goodbye. He said goodbye. He leaves. He tells his student, go. Don't allow him to leave the city. Don't allow him to go home. They try to stop him. He says, the Rebbe, don't make him go. Don't go again. He goes again. He says, goodbye. He goes again. He says, don't let him go. Back and forth a few times. The guy insisted to leave. He left. He went home and he died. And he says, I knew it's going to happen, but I couldn't tell him that. I was not allowed to tell him that. If he would stay by me, he would. As long as he doesn't go home yet, he's okay.
But he tried.
In any case, then, but the question is, God was upset with Miriam and Aaron. How dare you speak about my servant Moses? If Moses is doing something wrong, I'll tell him. Who are you to tell him what to do? Not that Miriam was, the problem was not so much the Loshanora and the this. The point is, Moses is God's servant, God's prophet. What are you giving him advice? He doesn't need aides. He doesn't need helpers. It's, you know, in this parsha from this week, we read about, you know, there were four groups on the sea. before the splitting of the sea. One group said, let's go back to Egypt. The other group said, let's go to war. The third group said, let's commit suicide, jump into the water. The fourth group said, let's dive. The all four were wrong. You know what they were wrong? Everybody's giving Moses advice. Now, yeah, a new cabinet. Everybody's telling him what to do. The normal thing would be to come to Moses and say, Moshe, what should we do? Ask Hashem, what should we do? Everybody's giving advice. Everybody has an opinion. That's what God is telling Miriam. How dare you spoke about Moses? If maybe Moses is doing something wrong. If Moses is doing something wrong, I talk to him every minute, right? I'll take care of it. Obviously, if he's doing it and I don't tell him anything, obviously it's not so bad. Then why are you to stick your nose? That was what God was upset. Why, then what happened? God displayed
anger against them and departed. When the cloud left its place over the tent, Miriam was leprous, white like snow.
She got leprosy. Why Miriam? Because Miriam told Aaron. Aaron was just a listener. It's not such a good thing, but Miriam turned to Aaron and told him, "How dear, the only God speaks to God speaks to Moses, speaks to us too." Miriam was the one who doubted Moses, who complained about Moses. You understand? Aaron just listened. But she got leprosy. Now, leprosy means you have to go out of the community. Especially in biblical time, leprosy was a statement. Leprosy was a sickness for every bad thing you did. Not just for, like people think, only for speaking Lashon Hara. There is many stories in the Bible of people got leprosy. It was a king, forgot his name, wanted to enter the holy temple, and it wasn't, and the Kohen stopped him by the door, and he wanted to hit the Kohen, and at that moment he got leprosy on his forehead, and he was locked up for the rest of his life. According to the Medrash, Cain, God said, "I'll put a sign on your forehead that nobody should kill you." What was the sign? According to the Medrash, was leprosy. The story with Elisha and Gehazi was a Naaman. It's a whole. There is plenty of stories with leprosy. Then that was like a statement that it's an outside thing that everybody can see. That God is upset, displeased with you. She got leprosy. Okay, continue. What happened?
When Aaron turned to Miriam and mm-hmm. saw her leprous, Aaron said to Moses, "Please, my Lord, do not hold a grudge against us for acting foolishly and sinning. Let Miriam not be like a stillborn child who comes from the womb with half its flesh rotted away." Moses cried out to God, "Oh God, please heal her."
Moses gave the shortest prayer ever in the Bible. 5 words. 11 letters? How many is there? I don't know. 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, 11. Kael no refon no lo. God, cure her. And finished. No options, no maybes, no nothing. I want you to do it. And God listens to the word of the tzaddikim. There is an interesting Talmudic statement that when somebody saves a child who was lost to Judaism, saves them to Judaism, he gets the power of God. God tells him, "You'll be like my mouth. Whatever you say will happen. If you give a blessing to somebody, it's going to happen." Guys, if you want to have the power of Hasidic rabbis, it's very simple. If you save a life, you save a Jewish kid to Judaism, God says you will have the power and your blessings will be fulfilled. Moses tells God what he wants, and it's happening. Okay, God said to Moses. You want to read? Right here.
God said to Moses.
Here comes the interesting part.
"If her father had spit in her face, would she not have been embarrassed for 7 days? Let her remain quarantined for 7 days outside the camp, and then she can return home."
Okay. And God said she has to wait for 7 days. Here comes the amazing reaction of the nation. Go ahead.
"For 7 days, Miriam mm-hmm. remained quarantined outside the camp, and the people did not move until Miriam was able to return home. The people then left for
Chatzerot and Afkemine." 7 days. It was a demonstration of love from the whole Jewish people. It's not written that Moses told them not to go. It's not written that God told them. The whole nation, naturally, from themselves, wanted to wait for Miriam. Miriam was so beloved to the Jewish people that the whole nation was waiting for 7 days. It's like almost like having a traffic, you know, it's like a jam. Nobody's moving. In the middle of the highway, nobody's moving for 7 days. Everybody's waiting for Miriam.
But are we following a cloud at this point?
No. They were following the cloud, but the way it's written is, it's not that the cloud told them not to move. The way it's written is that the nation stayed and they wanted to stay for 7 days. I'm sure that the cloud didn't go, because maybe the cloud moved and they didn't move anyway.
Well, but certainly a testimony from Hashem that the Jewish people wanted to be with Miriam.
Exactly. Could be even a message here that the Jewish people even decided for the cloud when it's going and when it's not going, ultimately. But here you see how much Miriam was loved. Then how we came up with this idea that Miriam, because of Miriam we got the water, because the story before we learned, Miriam singing, right after this is a story that the Jewish people complained that they don't have water, Moses got them water. The second, that we have three times in the Bible, three stories about Miriam we learn. Now we'll go to the fourth story, with just like two words about Miriam. Where is it? On page 763. Actually, 761. One line about Miriam in the bottom. Go ahead.
In the first month, the entire Israelite community came to the Sin Desert, and the people stopped in Kadesh. It was there that Miriam died and was buried.
Sounds very nice. Miriam died. Mazel tov. I mean, Baruch Dayan HaEmes. Miriam died. The next line.
The people did not have any water, so they began demonstrating.
What has suddenly happened? The people did not have any water. What happened? Talmud says Miriam died. There was no water. Miriam, Maim. Miriam was in charge of the water. Now, why Jewish people need water?
To survive.
Check the Torah.
Well, it's also for the mikveh.
Need for the mikveh. Jewish women will not have the children. They don't have a mikveh. That Miriam was always busy, that the Jewish women should have children. She was the one who made sure to provide a river, provide water for the Jewish people to have for the mikveh. Miriam was the mikveh of the Jewish people. She made sure that there is water for the Jewish people all the time. And therefore the Midrash says, then where is the, then wherever when the Jewish people used to travel, wherever they went, they found the water was walked with them. Somehow the water was there when they needed it. In middle of the desert, we're going to find water. It was water. It's an interesting thing. In the desert, what's harder to find? Water or food? Or food you can buy from the neighboring countries. Naturally, water comes from heaven. And food comes from the earth. In the desert, everything was upside down. Manna came from heaven, and water came from there from a river, from a rock. Right? Twice was from a rock. It was a rock that went with them, and somehow the water came out from it. And was all provided by Miriam. That Miriam was the one who gave the Jewish people the water to drink, and this water, the Talmud says, then the Miriam's river, so to speak, Be'er, how you translate Be'er? Be'er is not a river, it's a spring. Spring, whatever, is hidden in the Kinneret. And they say you can look in the Kinneret, the Midrash says, and you will see there is one spot where something is moving, like a little pot. This is Miriam's river. Basically, the Miriam's river came to Israel and is hidden somewhere in the Kinneret. That's why the Kinneret's water is sweet water, right?
Is she buried there?
Miriam is buried in the desert. Miriam did not make it to the land of Israel. Not Miriam, not Aaron, and not Moses. And that shows, Miriam died before the story of the eating of the rock. That shows that the tree didn't make it to Israel, not because they eat the rock, because they were the leaders of the Jewish people in the desert, and their generation died in the desert, and they stayed with their people. And now we know that Miriam means Maim, and Miriam was gave life. Maim is life, really, life for the Jewish people.
That's correct.